Hi guys, welcome back to Designing Test Automation Framework from Scratch. So as a part of this today's discussion, we're going to see at a high level overview how the Test Automation Framework project structure looks like. And also we'll review about some of the concepts like phase object design pattern. So how will we establishing our framework using the phase object design pattern, and what are the basic principles or the best practices that needs to be followed while creation of the test automation framework using the phase object design pattern. So first let's see the skeletal view of test automation framework is as presented over here. So this is the basic structure that is that we are going to achieve finally. So once we complete everything step by step, this is how the framework, project framework looks like at the end. So we have made it at a high level to understand each and everything when we are going to explain to someone. This is the high level, how it can be viewed, how the framework can be viewed. So in order to achieve an easy and maintainable project, what are the best practices that need to be followed? We'll be looking at. So our project directory structure is divided into four directories, four main directories or four main layers. So each directory or each layer is having a specific task assigned to it. So let's look into each and every directory structure and what does it contain, what are the helping files that will be available as a part of each directory. So project wrappers. So project wrappers are something which are used for customizing, which we are going to use the existing things and we are going to customize those things. We are going to customize those things in a way that is required by our project. As for our requirement of the project, we are going to modify the existing things. So this is what the project wrappers will be containing. For example, Selenium web driver commands. That is a Selenium API commands. That Selenium API that provides so many commands for working with the browser, for automating the browser. So we are going to take up those API methods which are necessary for us, and then we are going to modify or customize it in a way that is beneficial for our project. So how we are going to customize? We are going to customize the existing API methods by calling them in our test methods, in our wrapper methods, by modifying them or by customizing them with the support of exception handling, with the support of weights, etc. So we'll make them in such a way to suit the needs of our project requirement. So assume we need to wait for some time until an element is selectable or clickable. So we need to wait for some time. So the object identification should wait for some time. So we'll be using weights to customizing it using weights. So another Selenium command will not be waiting. If you click on an API command identifying an element, it will directly go and try to click. It will not wait for the time until it was clickable or it was selectable. So we need to provide weights. That is, we need to customize the existing Selenium command in such a way that based on our product requirement, we need to provide the wait times for the particular web driver API command to wait for that particular time. So that is how we are going to customize it. Also, we are going to have a second level customization. That is, we are going to use exception handling if an element is not present. So we had used the waits. So we had waited for some 30 milliseconds or 1 minute, and after that the element is not available. So at that point of time, what is the alternative path we have? So using exception handling, we'll provide the alternative path. So if it is not clickable, we need to take the alternative path. So that alternative path is provided by exception handling. So that is what we are going to cover as a part of project wrappers in the first level. And there is a second level, project wrappers, that we are going to customize. So we are going to customize the existing methods that are available in the interfaces of listeners. So extent reports has extent reports API as listeners, that is extent listeners. Even the test engine has provided some listeners. And also even the web driver has provided the event firing web driver listeners. So these all listeners are abstract methods. These are not implemented. These are unimplemented methods. So we need to take those listeners, those methods that are available as part of those listeners and modify in accordance to our needs. Assume like test execution started. So we wanted to print a message that this particular method, test method execution has started. This particular test method execution has ended. This particular test method execution failed. On failure, we wanted to take screenshots. So these are the customizations that we need to do. So those all customizations will be done at the project purpose level. So under project purpose structure, the hierarchy structure will be having the web driver related, web driver API related command that is customized using weights and exception handling, and then the listeners, that is the event reporter listeners, event report listeners, event report API provider listeners, event listeners, test engine listeners, which is the ITest engine listener is going to provide, the interface is going to provide set of methods, abstract methods. Those abstract methods we are going to customize and we are going to implement those things. And also Selenium WebDriver has given some methods, that is abstract methods. So that is the event firing WebDriver methods, event firing WebDriver interface has provided some list of methods. So on click, what it should happen. On selectable, what it should happen. So these all things will be there and we are going to customize those things in accordance to our project needs. So these are the things that will be available under project purpose. At the next level, pages. So this pages directory will contain. So basically, our using the page object design pattern, what we are going to do is like we are going to divide our project into pages. So home page, login page, and if there is some functionality called the reservation page, and if there is some functionality called booking, the booking page, checkout page, check-in page, etc. So our project is completely, our UI is completely divided into pages. So what these pages contain? The pages contain the web elements available on the pages. Also, which implies the web elements in the sense the objects that we are going to identify and identify for doing the operations on the particular objects. That is the web elements we are going to identify and we are going to provide those objects for the web elements on the pages, each and every page. And also we are going to create some methods. So the actions that needs to be performed on those identified objects or the identified web elements. So each and every individual page will wrap up the web elements available in the particular UI, particular page, and also the operation that needs to be performed on those elements. So these are the things that will be wrapped up under pages. So why we are going for pages? Why not all the objects at one place? So it is for easy maintainability. So if there is a change in login page, don't need to change it across multiple places. So at one shot, you can do it by navigating to that particular page so that the operations related to that particular web element only will be disturbed because only that particular operations will be utilizing that web element present in that particular page. So if you are going to have any changes on that particular object or particular web element, we are going to go and modify only that particular object related to the particular web element, particular element on the UI, so that only that particular page needs the changes. So it is for easy maintainability of the project. So we are centralizing the objects at one place and we are centralizing it into in the form of pages rather than having all at one place. And the next is the test folder. So the test folder will be containing all the tests that we are going to have, all the scenarios which we wanted to test it. So each test will contain, the test folder will contain different class files. Like each class file will contain, each test class will contain, test ng test class will contain one scenario or one test case that needs to be, one flow that needs to be executed, one flow that needs to be verified. So this is what our tests directory will contain. So we are going to work on the elements that are available in the web pages by picking up the elements or the objects and the test methods available in the particular page we are going to utilize in the test. So this is what will be available as a part of the test directory. And utilities. The fourth layer or the fourth directory structure is utilities. In utilities directory, we are going to have the supporting or the helper methods. So what are basically helper methods? So for achieving our test, we require some test data. So test data is provided by the data provider annotation. So with the support of data provider annotation and also Apache POI API for reading the data from the Excel, we are going to create a test method that is going to drive the test data to the test. So that is one of the things that will be one of the utility that will be available under utilities directory to support multiple test data input or to feed the test data to the test methods. We have a utility called data driven or data driver, which will be utilizing the data provider and the Apache POI API to read the data from the Excel file or the test data file and input it to the test. And what else the utilities might be there? So also reporting related utilities might be available so that the after execution of the test, proper reports should be formatted or proper report should be created. So for that also, we'll be having some class or some mechanism needs to be there. That mechanism will be also available as a part of utilities. And other than this, you can have. So this is generically, this as of now, whatever we discussed is generic. So any project, so I mean to say any project in the sense, it is not only Selenium Automation Framework project. It can be REST assured API testing project, or it can be APM Mobile Automation Framework. Any project for any different kind of automation project, this can be the generic framework structure that can be created. So once we have created this one, you can utilize the same thing for Selenium automation, you can utilize the same thing for REST assured API automation, you can utilize the same thing for mobile automation using API, because this is the generic part. All the things remain same, only our pages related information will be changed and the test related information will be changed, because it depends upon the project which we are dealing with. Project wrappers will remain the same. So project wrappers will depend. Project wrappers also will be changing. So project wrappers for listeners and all those things will be remaining the same. But the API methods, the project wrappers related to the API methods will be changing, because REST assured API will contain different methods, different API methods. REST assured provides REST assured API methods for working with API calls. Selenium will provide API methods for working with web browser. APM will provide some methods for working with mobile automation. So that will change. And utilities will remain the same. Pages will be depending upon the framework or the application that is at hand. And the test will be also depending upon the pages, and based on the application, it will be changing. So for the directory structure and the wrappers and the utilities remain the same, other than the wrappers for the particular API calls. So after this, in order to extend based on the project, our utilities can have one more helper methods that is related to the project. So project specific some methods we wanted to write. So that can be placed under utilities. So under utilities, we will have generic and project specific. So utilities with generic will be applicable to any project, any automation project. But with respect to, if you wanted to have some particular methods which is repeatable, which is repeated across, so that you wanted to modularize, those kind of methods will be picking up and will be placing under utilities folder, and it will create a separate class for saying that it is particular to the project. That is, it is not particular to the framework architecture, but it is particular to the project, the product. So generic and project specific utilities. So this is how basically our automation framework looks like, and this is the high level overview explanation of this thing. Now let's see in detail what level, at a class level, how the framework will look like, what will be extending what, the high level what will be there. So assume this can be our framework structure. So at the top level, the reporter related information will be there. The reporter class will be there. The reporter abstract class will be there. So that will have all the reporting customization related information and how it will be, how the report will be generated or using extent report and all those things will be available as a part of reporter class. And then below that class, WebDriver listeners will be there. So the listeners, that is as I told, the wrappers related information will be there. That is the wrapper specific, the WebDriver listeners, that is the test engine listeners and all those listeners will be available over here. And then this will be extended by wrapper methods. So wrapper methods extends this WebDriver listeners and implements the wrapper driver interface. So let's make it in another way. Let's come back from the base and go up to the top level in the hierarchy. So at the base level, we will have individual tests. So each and individual test will have some prerequisites. That is something which needs to be defined before and after test. So before running this test, we need to have something that is happening. After running this test, there needs to be something that is happening. That is prerequisites and post-requisites. As a prerequisite, we need to initialize the reporter's API. We need to initialize the data driver to call the particular input sheet and provide the data from there. And we need to initialize the web browser specific implementation methods, etc. We need to implement the listeners for customizing the reports and logging. So this needs to be done as a part of prerequisites. So we can see what needs to be done as a part of prerequisites and part of post requisites. We need to implement the logic that needs to be performed. So as a part of post requisites, once the execution is completed, if there are some failures, so that we need to take some screenshots of those failures. And then we need to report all the pass and fail related information. And we need to create a proper report and we need to place it in one place. So this is the information. This is the pre and post requisites that we need to define. So for any test, we have pre-test, before test and after test information. So what it will be there? You can see over here. What the pre and post steps to be implemented for every test case is like before shoot, we need to call the reporter class method and initialize it and attach the HTML reporter to the extent object. And before class, what we need to do is like call the method from the reporter class to create the hierarchy of the tests. And after and before the method, what we need to do is like before each and every method, we need to call the method for the reporter class to create the child level test. So it is basically like creating the tests at what level they should be there. This is a parent level test or a base level test. And after shoot, what needs to be executed is we need to call the reporter API to plus all the generated data, all the reported data, and put it in a report file. So this needs to be done. So as we already discussed, this is the prerequisite before running the test. We need to initialize all the things, and then we need to call the data driver to call the test data sheet, and then provide it as an input to the test. And after, so what we need to do is like collect all the information and then push all the information to the report. And also we need to take screenshots, and all those things need to be implemented at after shoot, that is post step. So this is all what we need to implement. So this is at the low level. So at the rate test is one time activity. So it defines, it is not common across, it is depending upon the business logic that needs to be implemented. It varies from test to test. But before test and after test, there is a pre and post requests are common. So this needs to be implemented in the base class, and that base class needs to be extended by each and every test. So when each and every test extends this base class, the pre and post requisites will be common for these tests. So whenever we are running the test, either a test, a particular test case will be executed, and before that, all the prerequisites will be executed because we are extending those tests before our current test. So that is over here. This is the test level. This is the lowest level in the hierarchy. So before that, the base test will be there. So the base test will have all the pre and post requisites, and our base test should implement the wrapper method implementation class. Why? Because all our WebDriver API commands should be available over here, readily available for our base test to extend those things. And then using that, so once it was extending, those methods will be available for our base class. So in the turn, it will be available for implementing or using in our tests. So all our tests can use this wrapper methods which are implemented now. So before that, so up to here we have covered. Now next level in the hierarchy, next in the top hierarchy is the wrapper method implementation, which is extended by base class. So our wrapper method implementation should extend the WebDriver listener over here. So why we need to extend WebDriver listener is that because the logging framework should be implemented so that the logging system or mechanism can be implemented in our wrapper methods. So when we are customizing the WebDriver API methods, we wanted to provide some logs. For example, if some test case has started execution, so we need to provide a message. That message will be provided by these listeners, because listeners are used for customized logging mechanism. So this should be the higher level in the hierarchy. So it should be above wrapper method implementation. So we can see it is above the WebDriver implementation. So now we are having WebDriver listeners. We need to have above this the reporting mechanism. Why? Because reporting mechanism is common across. So once we have it at the top level, it will be utilized anywhere in the lower level. So at the top level, reporting mechanism should be available. So reporter class will be at the highest level, and then followed by the listeners classes, and then at the next level we'll be having the implementation class, that is a WebDriver API methods implementation class, and post that we'll be having the base test related class, which is going to have the pre and post requisites, and below that we are going to have our tests. So now we have seen at a high level, so let's give a diagrammatical representation so that we can understand in a better way. So at the top level, we'll be having a reporting mechanism. And the next level, we are going to have the logging mechanism. That is the event-based logging mechanism. Now you are saying event-based logging is, after a certain event has occurred, we wanted to log it, or we want to do some particular task. Post that, in the next level in the hierarchy, we need to have WebDriver API commands, that is the wrapper methods. So we can say wrapper methods of Selenium WebDriver. Wrapper methods plus Selenium WebDriver. And next in the hierarchy, we are going to have the base test implementation, which consists of pre and post requisites that needs to be performed. Pre and post requisites. So we will be having pre and post requisites implementation, which needs to be performed before each and every test, each and every individual test. So at the final level, we'll be having the test which implements, which is going to incorporate the business flows. So as you can see, this is how the hierarchy is. This is how our hierarchy, our mechanism is established. So why this is done like this, as we already discussed. So this is done to get the best maintainability, or to understand it in an easy way. This is how the hierarchy is maintained. So maintaining the reporting mechanism at the highest level will provide the reporting mechanism for each and every individual level below it. So reporting mechanism provided at the highest level, so that all those things which have been unimplemented, like for example, on an event of failure, test failure, we need to implement something for that. So in order to show in the test case, we need to attach the screenshot. So that particular method needs to be implemented. So having this reporting mechanism at the highest level, so that we can have the abstraction, so abstract methods, so unimplemented methods, so that can be implemented while we are moving down the hierarchy. At a level of wrapper methods implementation, we can do it that. As a part of prerequisites or post requisites, we can incorporate those things. So next, at the event level, event logging mechanism. As you told, it is an evaporation over existing event mechanism. So what are the event listeners, the listeners that are available, the listeners that have been provided by the action reports, the action reports API, listeners that have been provided by test engine, listeners that have been provided to listen to the events that Selenium is performing. So those kind of events, we are going to log it using the logging mechanism. So for that, we are going to write all the methods. We are going to implement those interfaces, and we are going to implement the methods which are required as a part of our project for logging, event logging. So having this at the second level in the hierarchy will allow us to implement those things in the wrapper methods. Why? Because these wrapper methods are used for doing the actions on the browser. We'll perform any actions at a certain point of time. We want you to log some information. If something happens on a particular event, if you click something, you want to log it. So that logging mechanism should be implemented prior. So that has been done in the second level in the hierarchy, so that we can utilize it by extending those things. So that is the reason why we have been having event logging at the second level in the hierarchy. Next. The next level in the hierarchy is the base test. So base test, as I already mentioned, that is the pre and post requisites. So like what needs to happen before starting execution of the test? We need to initialize the reports API, reporter object, and all those things. And also we need to create the tests. We need to write the description of the test case. We need to call the Excel sheet for the test data using the data driver. So that kind of implementations will be there in prerequisites, the part of prerequisites in the base test, and the part of post requisites at the rate after suit. What we need to do is to plus the information to the report, whatever the information that is collected and executing each and every test, each and every business flow, that needs to be flushed into the report, and it needs to be displayed, the total execution related information. So that will be done as a part of the post requisites. And in the last level, lower level in the hierarchy, the tests will be there. which is used for implementing the business flows. So this is the mechanism, or this is the class level hierarchy structure that needs to be understood. So this is how our project framework or the project hierarchy structure or the skeleton is maintained to achieve maintainability and easy understanding. So now let's look at into phase object design implementation best practices. So these are some recommended and the best practices that needs to be followed in order to maintain our test project easily. So let's see what are the things. While implementing the reporting mechanism, we need to follow some set of rules. That is, every phase should implement the reports. And also, it needs to be used the reporters in each phase by centralizing it. That is what I told. So having this reporting implementation at the top level in the hierarchy allows us to implement or incorporate reporting mechanism in each and every phase. So that's what it says. So it says that reporting mechanism should be at the top level in the hierarchy such that each phase can utilize this reporting mechanism. And the next implementation rule is at the project purpose. So while implementing project wrappers, what are the rules that needs to be followed? As we already discussed, wrappers are those which provide an abstraction over the existing commands or existing methods, existing actions that are available, like the Selenium commands or the listeners, etc. Basically, we need to define at three levels these wrappers: wrapper methods for Selenium commands, wrappers for custom logging, and project specific wrappers. This is at the three levels we are going to make it. And the best practice that needs to be implemented while creation of phases is that every action should have a separate method. We mean to say that each and every thing that needs to be performed on an element, that is the object that we have created, should have a separate method related to it. And the second rule for having the best practice, under best practices, the second rule for phase creation is every method should return the object of the same phase. So why this is then? Because while writing the test, it should be in a very clear manner and should be understandable. Like it should be like enter username, enter password. So that should be like, how it should be like is like you need to call the login page. Okay, once calling the login page dot enter password dot enter username dot login. So this should be the hierarchy. So what I mean to say is it should be like this. Let me put it over here so that it can be understood clearly. So for login implementation, first we need to call the home page. So when we call the home page object, you'll get to the home page, and on the home page you have some information relating to login, the objects related to, elements related to login, that is home page dot. Okay. Home page dot enter username. Dot. So it should be like this. Assume it will be like this. Dot. Enter. Password. Dot. Login. So you can see, it is very readable. Anyone who is going through the test can understand what is the business flow that we are going to perform. So for attaining high level readability, we are going to follow this principle. You know, each and every phase, we need to follow this basic rule. Next basic rule that needs to be followed while creation of the phases is that successful phase launch validation should be implemented using constructor. So on successful launch of the login, okay, we are going to navigate to some separate phase. Okay. So that page, while we navigated successfully to that page, we need to validate some information on that particular page. Example, reached login successful. Assume on login, there is a message login successful on the next page that we are going to navigate to. So that needs to be validated whether that message is being shown or not. So that needs to be implemented using a constructor. So next one, so the next practices, like the next rule or the best practices that needs to be implemented at the test creation level. Let's see the rules for achieving the best practices at the test creation level. So every test should implement the reports, comma, project wrappers, as we already told. Why we are going to extend it, I mean, why we are going to have the reports, reporting mechanism and the project wrappers at the highest level is basically for this purpose only. So in order for every test should have these things available, we are going to incorporate this at the highest level so that every test can use these things. Excuse me. For working on every test, we will be requiring some actions that needs to be performed on the UI, on the browser. So for doing those actions should be available already. That is, at the project wrapper level, we are already wrapping up all the WebDriver API methods and we are customizing those according to the project specific needs. So those can now be incorporated or used at the test level. So that's the reason why we are keeping those reporting mechanism and the project specific wrappers at the highest level in our project structure. And next, that each and every test should have a proper assessment to verify the outcome. So these are the best practices that needs to be followed. So the best practices are segregated at various levels. Like while reporting implementation, there are some specific rules. While project wrappers implementation, we need to follow from this specific rules. And also while creation of the pages, we have specific rules. And also while creation of the test, we have the specific rules that needs to be followed to issue a high level readable, very readable and maintainable project implementation. So these are the best practices that needs to be followed or the rules that needs to be followed while implementing a page object design pattern for achieving high level readability and maintainability. So this is what we wanted to discuss. So this is all. Thank you guys. Thank you for watching.